home to be cared by Jesus. God.
Glory, hallelujah. Thank God for all of you this morning. We thank Him for your love for Him, your love for your family, your fellow man, and your desire to walk in the perfect way. Isn't it wonderful to know Jesus? Glory. To know Him is to be lifted above the mundane, the common, the insignificant, and to live your life on the highest plan. I'm going to ask that we stand for the reading of this word this morning. Our scripture is taken from Matthew, 2nd chapter, verses 1 and 2, and then we will go to verse 11. Matthew, 2nd chapter, verses 1 and 2, and then verse 11. Shall we read together, please? Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him." And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented him to them. Verse number 2 again. Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to. Thank you for your obedience. You may be seated. I want to speak to you this morning from a message entitled, Where is he? Where is he? Where is he? The birth of Jesus is no doubt the most monumental event in history. According to verse number 1, wise men came from the east, probably from Persia or some far distant land. They came from the east to search for Jesus. They did not know anything about the Jews' tradition, Judaism, their religion, anything. But they came from the east because they wanted to see Jesus. They came searching for Jesus. Then how did they know? How did they know that something unique, something exceptional had taken place? The Bible says that they were led by a star. Being astrologers and stargazers, no doubt they recognized that the star was different. This light was different than what they had normally seen. And so then, how did they know that something exceptional had taken place? They had no scriptures. They had no Babylonian Talmud. They had no Egyptian Talmud. How did they know? Two reasons why. First of all, they knew because of divine inspiration. You see, even if you don't know one scripture, God still can speak to your heart. And even if you take life for granted that the routine is going to take place, I'm going to go to bed tonight, get up tomorrow, I'm going to do certain things, I'm going to my job, come back, or wherever you might be, it becomes monotonous routine. But yet, God can speak to the routine things of your life. He can show you something extra that you had never seen in the thing that you customarily do. And so then it was divine inspiration. And divine inspiration having inspired their hearts to know and to believe that something exceptional had taken place, then God now engaged in divine provision. You see, whatever God inspires, he will make provision for that thing to be carried out. If he inspires you to serve in a certain capacity, God will make provision. He has already made provision for your resources, what you need in order to be successful. Success based on bringing glory to God. Success based on serving your fellow man, enhancing his or her life by the things you do or the words you speak. And so then, whatever God inspires, he makes provision for. He inspired them to search for the king, something new, something dramatic, something exceptional, and yet he provides them the provision. He provided a star for them. They could not find, like this, they could not find Jesus on their own. I'm not talking about the wise men, I'm talking about you. You can't find him on your own. You can't acquire the spiritual strength that you need to follow his precept on your own. You can't muster enough faith to deal with terminal illness or the threat of terminal illness on your own. You need some help. You can't love those who don't love you. You can't love folks who are constantly hurting you or misrepresenting you. You can't do it on your own. You need divine help. You can't walk the perfect path and resist evil and sin and say no continuously to the wiles of the devil except you get some divine help. You do good for a while, but after a while, the burdens of temptation, after a while, the glitter and the glamour of life will wear you down and you yield. I yield. In order to take up a cross and follow Jesus, in order to do that which is right on a consistent basis, we need some help. In order to forgive, do y'all hear what I'm saying? In order to thank God for you young folks, thank God for all of you if you have devoted yourself to leading us in an inspirational way this morning. We thank God for that. But you know, the beauty, the joy, the strength, the good, the excitement, the satisfaction that we have received from what you have done and what you have done could not come from human effort. It takes more than talent. It takes more than ability. It takes an anointing from on high that God would lift our natural tendency, our natural abilities, and place them in a category so that we can experience a little bit of heaven on earth. Didn't you have a little bit of heaven on earth here this morning? You're not answering me. I asked you, did you have a little bit of heaven here on earth already this morning? Through the reading of the scripture, inspiration, and through the singing of the song. Yes, they could not find Jesus on their own. They needed some help. No man can find Jesus on his own. No man can enter into a personal relationship with Christ on his own. To lead us to Jesus, to find Jesus, so to speak, and lead us to Jesus, we need some help. But thank God, I said that whatever God inspires, God will provide. And so then we need help in Father. We needed help to find in Jesus. And so then what did God do? He provided. He first of all, he provided us a Bible. And the Bible tells us in Romans 3:23, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible tells us that something needs to be done with our sin problem. Am I helping somebody? Something needs to be done with our sin problem. The Bible tells us, again, Romans 3:23, that all have sinned. I know how some of you are quoted, but it's not like that. But I'm going to go, but somebody's asking me, how do some of us quote it, Rev? I quote it, all have sinned, come short of the glory of God. How some of you quote it? Y'all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. John 3:16, the Bible tells us that God so loved the world, love past that, not love the world so much, but the emphasis is on so intensely. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That's what Christmas is all about. He has given us a Bible so that we can understand our condition is a sinful condition that we are unable to remedy ourselves. And then it goes on to say that God so loved the world that he gave us his son to deal with our sinful condition. And then for those who will say, well, isn't it the fact that you can, as long as you believe in somebody, as long as you have religion, he gives us the Bible. He gives us Acts 4:12. And Acts 4:12 say, neither is salvation in any other. For there is none other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Salvation comes through Jesus Christ. and him only. There's no salvation in Buddha. There's no salvation in Islam. There's no salvation in Confucius. There's no salvation in Maharaja Ji. There's no salvation in any other than Jesus Christ. The Christian religion is the only inspired religion that comes from God. Do you hear what I said? I don't care if it's Mecca or wherever it is. The Christian religion. Neither salvation is in anyone. Jesus is the only way to God. He has not only provided us with the church, he has also provided us, I'm sorry, with the Bible. He has also provided us with the church. Matthew 28, 19 and 20, he said, go ye therefore into all the world and teach men. Teach them about Christmas. Teach them about Jesus. Teach them about my love. Teach them about the sacrifice my son made. He's given us a church. Now I want you to notice that the magician, they did not have the scripture. They came a long way, but they found Jesus. It makes no difference how long you have to travel. It makes no difference how long you have to search. It makes no difference how long you have to go through your trials and your tribulation. If you can say, at the end of the day, I found Jesus. Not that he was lost, but I found his influence. I found him to be a keeper of his word. I found him to be faithful to his promise. I found him to be an ever-present help in the time of trouble. I found him to rock you whenever you get weary. I found him to be a doctor in a sick room. I found him to be a lawyer in a courtroom. I found Jesus. I found him to be a friend like no other friend. I found him to be a comforter for those who are disturbed. I found him to be joy for those who are in sorrow. I found him to be peace whenever I'm in confusion. Whenever you go through, whatever you go through, if you can come out on the other end and say, I found Jesus. I found him to be help when all help walk away. I found him to be a very present right now help. I found that something happened when I be still. I found when I be still, I see a salvation. I find out when I hold my peace, he fights my battle. I find out that when my mother and my father forsake me, he will pick me up. They found Jesus. And so then I come and ask you, where is he? Bible said when he came into the house, they asked, where is he? Where's Christ? He's on the right hand of the Father making intercession. I know that. But where is he? Where is he in your life? No, you sing about him, you preach about him, you talk about him, but where is he in your life in terms of influencing, controlling, motivating? Where is he in your life? You categorize it, you have entertainment, you have we call this recreation. We have sports. We have family affairs, and we have religion. We have spirituality. How do you categorize it? Where is he on your list? Is he at the top, the middle, or at the bottom? Where is he? Am I coming through? Where is he? Thank you, sister. Amen. I got my sister here in the amen corner. Thank God for you, darling. Good to see you again. Amen. Why? But where is he? When you are feuding with your brother and your sister, where is he? When you're trying to respond to some wrong that had been done you, or you think had been done you, when you're trying to respond to some injustice or inequality of life, where is he? Where do he fit in your way of thinking? When when you are arranging your battle plan, And how you're going to react. Where is he? When you are going to respond to the much hurt and pain and anger and bitterness, where is he? You take matters into your own hand, do your own thing, and then go back and say, well, I asked the Lord for forgiveness. Where is he in your life? Where is he in your relationship? The relationship at home, where is he? I told y'all the other day, the devil don't mind you living in the same house together. The devil don't mind you sleeping in the same bed together. He just don't want you to love one another. He don't mind us coming to the church. Yes, Lord. Hey, he don't mind you coming to the church. He don't mind you sitting on the same pew with your brother or your sister. But he just don't want unity to exist in the church, because he know if God's people who are called by his name shall humble themselves, seek his face, pray, and turn from their wicked way, he know that the power of God going to come down from heaven. God going to open doors. God going to make ways out of no ways. God is going to change hearts. God is going to save souls. God is going to take that frown off your face. Am I helping somebody? You listen to me, young people. God said they don't mind you going to school. He just don't want you to learn. He don't mind you gathering for rehearsal. He just don't want you on one accord. He don't mind you dressing up in your preaching attire or your serving attire. He just don't want a oneness that resembles the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Am I happy? Happy. I'm not going to say like some of the preachers saying this morning, I'm not going to keep you too long. I came here to keep you long. Amen. We need to be kept long. In the word of God. Am I helping somebody? And I don't know, I know you don't mind. I say a lot of things, I know that. And I know you don't mind because you keep coming back Sunday after Sunday. Somebody must be in help. Am I helping somebody? But you know I love you. And I thank God for you. Where is he in your life? Where is he in your home? Your home reflects the presence of Christ. Do your home reflect the presence of Christ? Is there a sweet, sweet spirit in this place? Where is Christ in your home? Where is Christ in your association in life? Where is he when you're on your job? Where is he when you're at the occupational party? Where is Christ? When you gather to celebrate in your association, where is Christ? That's the real question. Where is Christ? They didn't ask, where is Herod? They didn't ask, where is Agrippa? They didn't ask, where is Nicodemus? They wanted to know, where is Christ? And the ultimate question in life, when they relates to you and I and our existence and our purpose and plan for here, being here on planet Earth, the ultimate question is, where is Christ? Where is Christ? You see, where is Christ? Where is Christ? Will determine how you are affected by the past. Where Christ is going to determine how you're affected by the past. You see, if Christ is not in your life, you're still dead in sin and trespasses. If Christ is not present in your life, then you don't have an atonement. You don't have a covering for your sin. The past still exists. You started out on your way to hell and you're still on your way to hell. If Christ is not present in your life. If Christ is present in your life, that settles the past. All of my sins have been forgiven. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. My name been changed. I've been taken out of the kingdom of darkness. I'm now in the kingdom of life. It settles the past. I once was on my way to hell, but now I'm on my way to heaven. I once was without God, but now I'm with God. It settles the past. And it makes no difference what people say. I remember this and I remember that. And as if sometimes they forget that they got a past too. See, everybody got a past. It settles the past. The atonement does not apply to you. Redemption does not apply to you if you don't have Christ as your Savior. But not only does it affect the past, where is Christ and where he is will affect the present. Because if you have not Christ in your life and not yield to him, you have no high priest to stand between you and God. You have no advocate, one who walks by the side of another to fight your battle and to encourage your heart. If you have not Christ, you have not a spiritual teacher or guide, the Holy Spirit dwelling within you to lead and guide you into all truth. If you don't have Christ, you have no divine help or comfort in times of adversities, in times of disappointment, in times of trouble, in times of bereavement, and in times of tragedies. Who will you turn to? Who's going to help you? Who can you lean on? It's affect the present. The choices you make, the things you do, how you respond to life situations. I think I'm coming through to this. What Christ is going to affect the present. It's going to affect what you do today, how you celebrate. It's going to affect what you talk about and how you talk about it. If you got Christ with you, in spite of not being able to purchase everything you wanted to purchase, not being able to give to your loved ones and your friend what you wanted to give to them, and in spite of not receiving what you wanted to receive, no matter what the shortcomings and the limitations are, yes, if Christ is present, then you learn to be contented in whatever state you find yourself in. I didn't get this. I didn't get that. I couldn't buy a present. I just have to wait until February or March. But yet you got a satisfaction of knowing that the main reason for the season has been accomplished because he has made himself so visible to you and so helpful to you. But then, not only that, where's Christ would affect the future. It's going to affect where you end up at. It's going to affect where you spend eternity. It's going to affect what kind of reward you have if you've been faithful. Am I helping somebody? When you look at verse number 11, the wise men search for Jesus. And then their search was not in vain. They looked for him and they found him. Somebody said, I was searching for joy. I went many different places, tried many different things. But when I found Jesus, my search for joy was not in vain. Somebody said, I searched for completeness and meaning and fulfillment in life. And I went here, I went there. I went down Bourbon Street, I went up other streets. But yet, when I found Jesus, I found all that I needed. I found help, I found joy, I found peace in the midst of sorrow. And even when it rained in my life, I still have a joy, I still have a peace, because I know that it, no matter what comes my way, he is able to take me from where I am and lead me to where I am. They found Jesus. But where did they find him? I don't have too much longer. Where did they find him? The Bible said when he came into the house, they found Jesus in the house. And running on, my question to you is, can he be found? Can he be found in your house? Another question will determine whether he is found in your heart, in your house, will be, can he be found in your heart? Can he be found in your conversation? Can he be found in your relationship with others? Can others see Jesus in your attitude and in your behavior? Those folks who have rubbed you the wrong way, can they see Jesus? It may not be because they just don't like you. It may be because Satan had asked for permission from God to vex you, to prove that you are only Christian when things go good. I'm under the impression that Satan, he always on his job, but I believe that for the most part, he visited on the people of God lightly on Sundays. And when he asked for permission, he asked for permission on Monday. He said, I don't want to mess with them on Sunday too much because they got their religious clothes on, they got their religious talk, they got their religious attitude. And if you notice, Gabriel, some of them got religious walk. So I don't mess with them too much on Sunday, but Lord, give me permission to catch them rascals on Monday. I'm not going to mess with them too much in the home, but let me deal with them on their job. Let me get them from around other church folks. Let's see how they act then. And can folks see that you know him? Can they see him in your behavior, in your attitude? When you look at verse number 11, again, we see the purpose for which they sought Jesus. Reverend Mitchell brought this out as well. We see here that the purpose for them seeking Jesus was to worship. Our ultimate purpose for receiving Jesus into our heart should be salvation and lordship. To save us and to submit ourselves to him, to obey him in all that he asks us to do. That should be our purpose. The purpose for confessing Christ, the purpose for being baptized in his name, the purpose for joining a local church ought to be because you believe that he can save you. You need a savior, and it ought to be because you want to submit yourself to him because you recognize that you cannot keep yourself. You need somebody that is higher than you. Somebody that is better than you. Somebody that is stronger than you. Somebody who can inspire you and lift you above your normal human tendencies and give you the grace and the strength that you need. So that others can behold you and say, like they did in the book of Acts, they took notice that they must have been with Jesus. Am I helping somebody? You ought to want to submit to his rule. Listen, he will. He will supply all of your needs. The fact is that when you humble yourself, he takes control. We see that purpose for seeking Jesus is to worship. Some say, I seek him for his favor. I seek him for financial security. I seek him for his protection that he gives in trouble. I seek him because I want him to supply all of my needs. Listen to me, though these should not be your primary purpose for seeking Jesus or going to church, yet the fact is, when you humble yourself to him and submit to his rule, he does all of these things. See, I don't have to look for somebody to provide financially for me if I seek Jesus. He's going to provide for my need. My God shall supply, not some, not most, not many, not a good bit, but my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. He will make ways for you where there is no way. He will open doors of opportunity. You need a breakthrough. You need some help. You need a change in your situation, your circumstance, or your attitude. See, Jesus, that's the answer. He is the answer. You're waiting on your connection. You're waiting on your connection. You've been waiting on your connection, and your connection have not gotten through, come through for you. Seek Jesus. He is able to supply all of your need. He is able to make life meaningful and purposeful. And he allows you and enables you to be contented until a change comes. You can be happy in the midst of trouble. You can be contented in the midst of sorrow. When Christ is in control, somehow, in some way, he communicates to us that if you trust me with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding, I will guide and direct you. You better believe that today. That's the way it is. He answers prayer. I shared with my wife earlier during the week. So you're talking morning. Were you up? Yeah, I had to get up. Listen to me, this is real. I had to get up again for 5 minutes to four and pray for over an hour. You know why? Because there was some bitterness and some anger was trying to creep into my heart. A lot of pastors won't tell you that because they are Holy Ghost all the time. But I'm telling you, I knew Satan was trying to get through it and trying to develop some attitudes in me about certain things and situations. I got up on my knees and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. And let me tell you, I'm here to tell you that if you pray and call on him, if you yield to him, if you acknowledge that you got some problem in dealing with certain people and dealing with certain situations, if you acknowledge that, let me tell you, God will give you the grace, the love like you're supposed to love. God will give you the grace. Somebody know what I'm talking about here. You don't have to fool yourself and trying to fool nobody else that you love all the time, you want to love her, and you satisfied with your family all the time. That's not the case. The case says nobody's off limit to Satan. And he tried to mess with me. And I recognize I wasn't no match for Satan. But I know somebody who fought a many battles and never lost. I know somebody who is able to change the heart and keep your focus. You open doors, I'm closing, of opportunities. He will bring you through the danger. He will help you to escape the snares of Satan. He will bring you through troubles. He'll bring you through your struggles. Where is he? I'll tell you where he is. He is right here this morning. Walking down every aisle, visiting every pew, saying, Christmas is about me. Christmas about me. Christmas is about me coming to help you. Coming to bear your sorrow. Christmas is about me. Christmas is about me taking your place, dying your debt, living your life, forgiving you for. Where is he? He is in every hospital, guiding the hands of doctors and nurses and others. Where is he? Is in the hospital at the bedside of many patients, telling them, fear not, for I'm with you. Where is he? He is here today. He's here saying to us, I'm here to keep you by my power and by my love. I'm ready to grant you salvation if you're lost. Where is he? He's ready to forgive. To forgive us for our sins. Where is he? He says, I'm here. First Community Offering, Antioch, offering my strength to those who are weak and feeble. I'm here to pick up those who've been beaten down by the pressures of life. Where is he? I'm here offering hope to those who have been excluded and written off, those who have been forgotten. Where is he? I'm here saying to those who've been abandoned by loved ones and friends that I am a friend that stay closer than a brother. I will never leave. I will never forsake you. Where is he? He is here today inviting the weary and heavy laden to come and find rest in him. He is standing with me You're standing inside of me, telling me to tell you that there is a fountain filled with blood. That fountain is drawn from Emmanuel's vein. And sinners, if you plunge yourself beneath this flood, you can lose all your guilty sins. And you say, my sins are many. I've done so much. But he's telling me in the close to tell you. The dying lamb, his precious blood, shall never lose his power. It's going to last. Till all the ransom church of God be saved to sin no more. I love preaching. I love preaching. Glory, hallelujah. That may be one of you. That may be any one of you. Where is he? He's knocking on the door of your heart right now. He's knocking on the door of your heart, telling you, if only you open, I'll come in. By letter, by Christian experience, candidate for baptism. May come this morning and say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. If you are present, God has spoken to you. You can come. Give your life, give your heart. Glory, hallelujah. By letter, by Christian experience, candidate for baptism, you may come and say yes. Yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. Salvation will be his gift to you on Christmas Day. A surrendered heart and a surrendered life will be your gift to him on Christmas Day. Thou art strong. Again, by letter, by Christian experience, candidate for baptism. You may be seated. Thank you for your obedience. Glory, hallelujah. Life is over. Time for me will be no more. No matter what is said, no matter what is done, it doesn't matter. Guide me gently. Glory, hallelujah. To that king, I'm sure. Once again, just a closer walk with thee. A close warden. Oh, Lord bless you real good. And the Lord keep you. New Year's Eve service. Be at 8 o'clock. We will serve the Lord's Supper at the conclusion of the service. Amen. Let us come and share together. Bring your friend with you, your neighbor. Amen. Love you so very kindly. Again, Merry Christmas. And the rest of the day. And I'm not going to go through all that, keep Christ in the Christmas and all of that. You know now who it's all about. All of our college and going away from home students, where you stand at this time. Amen. So good to see you. So good to have you all home. We thank the Lord for you. We love you all so much, very much. And we're always praying for you. Yes, we thank God for you. Amen. Yeah. Will you identify yourself? Ms. Johnson? Yeah. Amen. God bless you. We're so grateful for your presence this morning, all of you. And Brother Brian, Mother, I'll forget her name, but we thank God for you, darling. Amen. Linda, mother-in-law. We're always good to have you in the service, my daughter. We thank the Lord for you. And all of you, our visitors and our friends who have come to share, we're so grateful for you. We want to continue in prayer. I ask you sometime to go pray that God will guide and direct me into our next project. And hopefully we can get started with this in around April or May. So then we let us all be in prayer so that God will give guidance and God will give understanding. Amen. Brother Cooper. Yeah. Beasley, where you stand, my friend? In your white. Amen. God bless you. So good to the Beasley. Amen. God bless you. Amen. So good to see you.
I'm not going to be long, but just long enough to do this. And thank you, Pastor Gann, for that wonderful message.
God bless you, my friend.
I pray that God would continue to use you in your service. And on behalf of our music ministry, I want to present you with this small token of our appreciation and for what you've done for us and still doing for us and leading this congregation as well. And we just want to say Merry Christmas to you and Sister Gaines.
Amen.
And thank you very much, guys.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. I love you too. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all. Appreciate everything you're doing. I'm so grateful for you. I'm blessed to pastor fine folks like yourself and all of you. And I'm glad that you mentioned that because I wanted to say on behalf of myself and my wife, I want to say we thank you for your calls. We thank you for your monetary gift. We thank you for your food gift and all that you do throughout the year. I just want you to know that we are very grateful, very, very grateful. We have no doubt about your love and your appreciation. You show it on a consistent, constant basis. And I want you to know that we are very grateful. Amen? Amen. Amen. God bless all of you again, and the Lord keep you. Shall we all stand? Hmm? 7:30? Press.